All right, we start our work session. Mr. Carpenter, you want to run us through the work session?
Yes, Mr. Chairman, members of council. The agenda that we'll be discussing tonight, first thing is we start with a presentation from Fine Arts Center and Ms. Kristen Cobb and Karen Eckford and anyway, Kristen.
Okay, great. How is everyone?
Good.
How are you?
Good, nice to see everybody. I was here about a month ago and gave you guys a package of information requesting some funds from the ATAX pool of money in reference to our project that we just completed, which is the Jim and Pat Watts Performing Arts Wing, which is attached to the back of the Bassett Building. And I provided you some information at that point in time. What we have requested at that time to finish the project is a total cost of about $125,000. I requested $75,000 when I came before council, and you guys asked for me to please come back to a work session. So I am here to answer questions or give you any further information you may need about the project, donors, anything that would help you guys make a decision for the best interest of the Fine Arts Center.
Mr. Chairman, I have a couple of questions.
No, somebody's trying to give us an answer.
Yes, yes.
Well, these aren't all. Anyone, you want me to hit the button? Can everybody hear or?
It's real hard, it's one switch.
Wrong switch.
Apparently harder than you thought.
It's a big round knob.
I think they can hear us, can't they?
Yeah, sure.
Can you hear me?
Yeah.
I just don't know if my voice carries good enough without a microphone. Listen. I think the Fine Arts Center provides a tremendous service to Kershaw County. I don't think any of us up here disagrees with that. You know, they have come to us earlier, previously, they pounded me to death about needing funds for this project. I know we have some money sitting aside. That doesn't mean that we have money to always spend. But I would really like, if there's any questions that we have, to ask those questions tonight. Let's come to a clear understanding as to where we are with them. And I'd like for us to contribute or make a contribution to them out of our ATAX money. And I'd like that decision to be made tonight. And I would like to see this council at least give them the $75,000 that they're asking for. Thank you.
Mr. Jones, you can't make a decision tonight.
I'm not making a decision. I'm saying I'm telling them what I'd like them to do. Mr. Ken DeVos. Okay. Thank you.
That's fine.
Did it sound like I was asking them for a vote?
Yeah, it did. Me and the rest of us.
Well, how about listen to what I'm saying next time? Okay, I'm making a comment.
It's our fault.
End it all.
I have a question.
Yes, sir.
You know, being a business person, I always like to know what kind of return on investment. Have you quantified any kind of return on this in terms of more activities or bigger activities? Or you might have more events, you might have bigger events.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, I don't have any hard figures tonight, Gene, but I can certainly get that back to you. But we've already been utilizing the space. I'll give you an example. When I pulled out the parking lot tonight, we have over 55 youth in Fame Junior, which is opening tonight at the Fine Arts Center. We've already sold over 200 tickets, so we've got that space being utilized for those folks, because in the meantime, we have a full campus of education activities going on, and then the Douglas Reed House, which is where my office is housed, and Christmas Story, which is another community production involving about 45 folks, they're using that space. So the constant use of the facility, that's going to allow us to be able to do more productions. It also opened up the outdoor pavilion when we're doing free concerts that we do the last Friday of the month. That's given us coverage back there. We just did a benefit concert for a local musician whose wife just passed away. So we're using that space already very, very much more so than we could have before. And then there's some storage issues. For those of you who may not know, our costumes were stored in the upstairs above the hallway, and actually the roof trusses were cut out of the ceiling, you see, Brian will appreciate this, and so I'm surprised the ceiling never fell in. So the costumes have been moved out of there when they were appropriately being stored in this new facility so that we can be safe and keep things when people bring things to the Fine Arts Center, a lot of archival costumes, old history things, like the school candidate will call, and the school district will call and want to borrow costumes for things, and we didn't have a way for them to safely look and borrow the things that they needed to do, so we'll be able to do that in the new space, as well as take care of some other storage issues. And and I'm just being honest with you, that doesn't relate to the tourism piece, but that is another piece of the building. We do anticipate scheduling a lot more events, one night, type things with even local performers, because in this new space it's concrete flooring, so you can do food and drinks in there, so you can actually have movie nights, impromptu, like improv nights, comedy nights, you can do program speakers. If you guys had somebody that wanted to come in and talk about economic development, you could use that space, because it's a large open space and you can have food and beverage without worrying about carpet and those type of things. So we see it as being a very, very multi-use facility.
Thank you. I think he answered my question. Any other questions?
My question is more directly towards the administrator as far as is there any other projects or other organizations that that you have in mind that have requested funds from that funding, and what's the balance of the remainder? So we'll know what we're dealing here with, because I want to make sure that we're considering everything as we're making this decision and knowing what you may have a plan to present to us in the future as well, and I don't want to deplete the funds if that's a project that I'm interested in as well.
Thank you, Mr. Tucker, members of council. There's several entities in the community that have various times expressed an interest in county support. I know that the previous time when the council went through the full process of listening to requests, it was the Chamber of Commerce, Historic Camden, the Equine Center. They had all requested, the archives had all requested support from the county. The balance is, it's a little over $200,000 in the balance. Again, that's, as Mr. Jones pointed out, that's not recurring money. That's an accrued balance over time that when it's expended, it's gone, it won't be replenished, but it is there currently. So. My understanding is the Equine Center has got some fairly well-developed plans for finishing the facility with another pavilion. I understand that, again, the Chamber of Commerce has got some very well-defined needs as well. What I would, with councils, if the council desires me to do so, I would be glad to contact the entities that I'm aware of out there and see where they stand with those requests and provide that back to council if that's your desire.
As one councilman, I would like to know that, where we're at, because like I said, these monies, I mean, I may not ask them for all of it, but I want to try to put the big picture together before I make a decision for me. As one.
Currently, the only entity that has formally requested is the Fine Arts Center at this point.
So what's the amount of recurring monies that are generated by the accommodation tax?
The county's accommodation tax is funded by the head tax, if you would, on the beds of the hotel. And it's roughly $150,000 is our budget. That includes support from the city of Camden for our tourism. So part of that money goes to the Chamber of Commerce to run the visitor center. So that's how we run the visitor center. That's how we run our new tourism office. That's also how the ATAX committee provides its support as mandated by law, the 30% support.
All right, well, then I guess what I'm trying to get at, and I understand where this balance came from. We went through this about a year ago. Of course, money wasn't utilized for over a course of a period of about 6 or 7 years, and I recall that. But what is not designated, how about that, as far as recurring funds? I mean, it sounds like some of the money now, some of that $150,000 is going to our tourism office. I'm glad that it is.
Well,
supporting that.
Right.
But you're saying that we're not going to have any more, it's all of that has been designated here forward. Is that what you're saying?
Yes, sir.
All right. So this, we won't have any of this money for these sort of capital projects, if you will, in the future.
That's correct.
Okay.
At least not for this source.
All
And that's why I came before you for this specific capital project, because I think the will of the council was that this money should be used for capital type investments. And we did raise, you know, close to $500,000, almost $600,000 of our own. And current support from the county is $2,250 that goes into my operating budget. My operating budget is about $700,000. So I'm not asking for any sort of money that I would expect to come back on a recurring basis, but if there was this balance of money that council felt like should be used for a capital investment, I feel like this project with the Fine Arts Center is a very worthy investment for the county.
Mr. Garrett.
Thank you, Mr. Chair. Question for the administrator. I know we just newly hired tourism director. Did he, I guess, sit down with the Fine Arts Center, even though we know they approached us asking in reference to the $75,000? Did he see, would it be beneficial to invest $75,000 into the Fine Arts Center? Because the Fine Arts Center basically deals with tourism and stuff like that.
I'm not aware that he's at that particular meeting. He has certainly met with the Fine Arts Center and sort of spent time with them, working with them, but I'm not aware that he necessarily met on this particular project.
I told him that I was making a request, because I let him know that I thought it was important and that you guys indicated some intention to support a capital project like that. So I did share that with him in one of our conversations. And he has met with me. In fact, he rode with me to North Central to hear some musicians we brought in from Denmark. The Danish String Quartet was just here. So tourism dollars at work. And he went with me to North Central to hear them perform for the schools up there. And he and I had a nice conversation there. And I'm certainly very supportive of his efforts, and I'm going to, you know, help him in any way I can.
Well, basically, I'm just trying to piggyback off what Sammy just said. Because if he had like a plan, because I know he came before us and presented a plan for bringing tourism dollars into Kershaw County, and what would be beneficial? Would it be the Chamber of Commerce? Would it be Equine Center? Would it be the Fine Arts Center? What do he see as, and you know, where we should be sinking our dollars into? Being the tourism director.
Yes, sir. And I know that if he is able to give council some opinions and some thoughts on projects as well, and I certainly wouldn't mind if council desires, we come and discuss that at the next meeting or at a work session, to what his opinions and thoughts are.
Mr. Chairman, if I may, I'd like it to be on the agenda for this. Well, it is on the agenda. I would like for council to be ready to make the decision this coming Tuesday night. I don't want to see any more studies. I want to see more comprehensive plans. I think Mr. Wise, said it very well when he said, what is our return on our investment? And the director just sat up there and she went through a multitude of things that the Fine Arts Center brings to Kershaw County. You know, the Fine Arts Center is here tonight. I understand that, listen, I'm a big supporter of the Chamber. I'm a big supporter of the Equine. They're not here tonight, guys. We have $300,000 sitting there. It's not a recurring amount. We can't continue. This is a capital project. We all understand that. But let's get down to the nuts and bolts. Let's help these folks. They've got a capital project. It is a great return on our investment. I think the chairman has made that clear with his question and their answer. I would like to see us make a decision, give these folks some money, let them move forward with their capital project. And then if these other entities want some of the money, they can come before us and make their request. They're not here tonight, so I'm not talking about them, I'm talking about the Fine Arts Center. And that's what I want to deal with, and I'd like to move forward. No more delays.
Yeah, and I'm not necessarily opposed to that, Councilman James, but my question is it on the agenda for Tuesday night?
It was supposed to be.
It says work session.
I have requested that it be in the work session, which meant it was supposed to be on the agenda for this coming Tuesday night, and if it's not, I want it on the agenda for this coming Tuesday night.
If it's not, the only problem with that is if it's not already on the agenda, then the time period for getting on the agenda is closed.
Somebody certainly miscommunicated with me if it's not on the agenda.
Again, as the agenda is written, it indicates it's for the work session. that's how the agenda is written.
I'll be glad to share it. I mean, these numbers that I presented was a $4.3 million in economic impact annually to the center, over 10,000 audience participants. And so our focus is to continue to bring people into the center on a tourism-related basis as well as enhancing this community. And I will do whatever is the council's will in terms of if you need to come back to another meeting or whatever is
I have a question, Mr. Chairman. Just want some clarification. If an item is to be placed on the agenda, how much notice has to be given, Mr. DeBose?
Once the agenda is published, it cannot be amended. That's a recent rule by Court of Appeals.
We can delete, but we can't add.
Can't amend it, you can table things. You don't have to act on things, Mr. Tucker, that's correct, but you cannot amend the agenda once it's been published.
All right, for the second time, I will say I want this on the agenda for the following meeting.
Chairman.
I'm just saying, I want it clearly understood. I thought it was going to be on the agenda Tuesday night, guys.
What I would just like to say, that gives you plenty of time to do the research. I think Councilman Jones would like to have all of our support, so be able to do due diligence on maybe some other questions that we may have, not trying to do a delay tactics, but make sure that I ever take a yes vote in support of versus a no vote, because I don't have enough information to go on with the questions that we asked tonight. So that is my position. I'm in full support of having it on the agenda for next meeting this month and get it done and over with.
Appreciate it.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Appreciate it, Christian.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you.
Good night.
Mr. Chairman, the next item is a discussion of rezoning Sun Valley Drive. What this situation is a neighborhood in the county has been discovered that when the county zoning plan was passed, it was not zoned appropriately for the current uses of the neighborhood, the Sun Valley Drive neighborhood. It is essentially a community of mobile homes, and an individual has come requesting to be able to put a mobile home on a vacant lot where there used to be a mobile home, and current zoning would not allow that to happen. So what we're requesting is that council initiate a rezoning to send it to the Planning Commission so they can start the process of getting this neighborhood zoned as if the current uses are and as the residents of the neighborhood are requesting.
Just an oversight when we did the plans?
Yes, sir.
I think we had a similar thing about a year ago where...
I believe so, yes, sir. So this is a case where they have a petition that was part of the process that apparently is unanimous support for the neighbors to rezone it. And this allows, again, the map to reflect reality.
Okay. Thank you.
This is going to go to the public hearing in three readings, just like
that. Yes, sir. It'll have to go to the Planning Commission. So what we will do is we'll send it to the Planning Commission on Tuesday. They'll go through their process, and then we'll come back to him for approval.
Okay. Next.
Thank you. Next thing is, again, it'll be the Planning Commission. If you recall last month, you received in your boxes the five-year update and review, or the five-year update of the comprehensive plan.
Yes.
Planning Commission now going to give you that update and review.
Mr. Chairman, thank you for your time. I'm Louis Shaw, I'm the chairman of the Planning Commission. We have George Gibbons here, also the vice chair of the Planning Commission. We do appreciate your time. As Vic said, this is an updated comprehensive plan. The 10-year comprehensive plan was actually, the big update was in 2016. The Southland Planning Act requires us to, every 5 years, do an update. And because we have some new figures in for the 2010 census, and there's some other things that we wanted to fix in this process, we felt like we needed to go ahead and do it. Also, the 2007 Planning Act was amended to include the Priority Investment Act. And in that act, it requires the Planning Commission to have a priority, to add a priority investment element to the comprehensive plan and also a transportation element. And priority investment element is supposed to analyze what sources of funds might be available over the next 10 years for infrastructure projects and facility projects, and ask the planning commissions to recommend projects for those expenditures. And transportation element asks us to consider transportation facilities, including major road improvements, new road construction, transit projects, pedestrian and bicycle projects, and other elements of transportation network. So what we wanted to do here, before you all actually see it for first reading, we'll just give you just some highlights of what the changes would include, and be available to answer any questions that you may have tonight. And John Newman's prepared the presentation for you. Yes, John.
Thank you. And I guess everybody got a copy of this memo here. It's got the changes that were done to the plans. It's the hard copy. And these were as a result of the planning commission's response and public comments received. And I know you've got a full agenda, so I'm going to go through very quickly through this, which I will just give you a few of the high points. As you know, we had the 2020 census. We're still growing. We've got about 61,700 people. We've been averaging about a 15-70% growth rate over the decade since 1970. We're, I think, number 14 in the state as far as growth rate is concerned. The housing element, we've seen the diverse housing types are needed because this follows a national trend of decline in household size. There's just less people per household, which means that we need more houses. There's a growth in old age households, the growth in non-family households, single parents, and just single people themselves, and a growth in single parent households. And if you look at the specifically with Kershaw County, between just the 10 years between 2000 and 2010, we've experienced about a 30% growth in all of these categories. So it's very real across the nation and in the county. So it shows that we need a diversity of housing types, you know, much more than the predominant single-family household which we have now. One thing that the amendments to the 2007 Planning Act, which Lewis didn't mention, required us to include in our housing element a discussion of affordable housing. Said it's required by the Planning Act, and we were required to explore market-based incentives to encourage affordable housing. A good response to that would be to recommend a new zoning district for the county. This would be, we wouldn't pre-zone anything, it would be by petition by the developer. It would be zoned one thing, and they would ask to be rezoned to this new thing. And some of the elements in that would be higher density housing, closer setback requirements, you know, from property lines, interconnected multi-use streets, mixed residential housing types, which I just demonstrated there's a great demand and need for that. Neighborhood-oriented commercial uses and public spaces, civic and institutional uses. That wouldn't be a requirement, but that would be one thing that could go in. And there would be a requirement for inclusion of affordable housing. Whatever the percentage is, 15-20%, you know, that's up to discussion of the units available would have to be affordable housing. And of course, you know, we would develop regulations that in our zoning land development regulations and put that in front of you for consideration. Moving on to cultural resources, the one thing I wanted to talk about was the Battle of Camden site. As you guys know, we're in the process now of applying for a national park status. The money's pretty tight. We don't know how that will happen, but if you take a look at the map there, the outer ring there is the preservation design proposed by Historic Camden and the Kershaw County Historic Society to not only cover the whole area of Battle County, the size of a buffer area. The president's strategy would be, of course, you know, to support and pursue National Park designation. Passage of this in the comprehensive plan would give a very strong signal to the federal government that we're serious about that. Failing that, to go after state park status, the state has been shown interest in it becoming a state park, but we know federal and state funds are very tight now. And so the next line of defense would be to work with the private landowners within that area to have some sort of conservation easements, if they were willing to do so, to preserve the area. And the third strategy would be to develop an overlay district, which would limit some uses in the area to traditional uses, homes, churches, schools, but certainly not power transmission lines, cell towers, and things of that nature. The transportation element, Lewis really hit the highlights of that. It's meant to, it's required by the Comprehensive of the Planning Act to be included, and it's a multimodal analysis of our inventory structure. The one thing that's I wanted to point out here is if you see that pink area around Elgin and the outside area, that's the area currently now in the Central Midlands Metropolitan Planning Area for transportation studies. It's the urbanized area. The rest of the county is in the Santa Ynez Regional Council of Governments. They're rural planning, transportation planning. Because of the new census, those darker areas are the heavy urbanized areas. That yellow area is more than likely going to be the new boundary for the Central Midlands, what's called the COATS, Columbia Area Transportation Study. That's the Metropolitan Planning Organization, which I now represent the county on. There were several meetings a month there. So you can see a significant portion of the county will be covered in there, which will have an impact to our transportation, which we have, you know, it covers all of Camden and a major chunk of the West Waterloo area. The priority investment element is as Lewis said, a new element that's required. The element has all the requirements of the Planning Act in it, but the part we wanted to talk about were some major capital project recommendations that the Planning Commission has. And these are nothing, none of these are going to be surprises. Most of them have been identified in the COP plan, 2006 to 2016 comprehensive plan. Others have been consistently recognized by the Planning Commission's annual capital improvement program effort. And they've been frequently discussed by department heads, administration, and or county council over time.
We just haven't done anything yet. Is that what you're saying?
I'm not saying anything.
All right.
The Planning Commission thought it might be convenient or useful to break these projects down into categories. They're all priority investments, so it's not like these are top priority and these are lower, but just in the categories. And these are the same categories as we used the last CIP that was done. The priority one projects are new facilities or improvements that are required to meet federal or state mandates. That would be, importantly, the American with Disabilities Act, the federal highway and state DOT, highway standards and bridge standards, FEMA, and the EPA and other requirements like that. Priority two projects would be the repair and renovation and replacement, just to keep up the status quo of keeping our current facilities necessary to achieve efficient operations and maintain existing levels of service and eliminate public hazards. It's mainly, you know, holding the line with what we have. In priority three projects, they're new facilities, expanded facilities improvements, which are meant to either promote economic development or keep up with new growth and development. As you see, we, in the last 10 years, we've added 8,000 or 9,000 people to the population. We'll have to, you know, respond to that with new development or new facilities. Okay, among the priority one projects is a correction facility. This facility has a design capacity of 89 inmates. In 2006, when we did the comp plan, there was an average of 135 inmates. The first 5 months of this year, the average was 225, and the design capacity is 89. We're just going to have to do something. But we don't know what, you know, until we would recommend the $40,000 be dedicated to facility condition assessment and space study by somebody that's an expert in that area to give recommendations of, you know, what can be done in the short term and what's going to be needed to be done in the long term. Bridge replacement program. You guys budgeted $106,000 for public works or engineering, I'm not sure which department was in, to hire a consultant to do an assessment of all the county bridges and road stream crossings, which are, I think there's 25, 26 crossings, bridges and crossings on the county roads. Five of them are currently closed now. Others are in not very good condition. Once the study is done and they're going to make priority recommendations, they may not recommend opening all these closed roads. We recommend that the county develop a capital improvement program for these bridges. The problem is not going to go away. The fire service made specific recommendations, and the Planning Commission supported a transition to a full-time paid fire service supplemented with volunteer force. I don't know if we would ever be, you know, without our much-needed volunteers. And to do that, some of the fire stations would need to be upgraded to accommodate full-time staff with sleeping quarters. And also they recommended to implement the fire apparatus replacement schedule. Fire apparatus are tanker trucks and ladder trucks that is in the plan, their recommendations. The sewer and wastewater treatment recommendations, the consultants just completed an update to the master sewer plan. It's a 20-year plan. For sewer, their recommendations are to concentrate in the West Watery area for treatment. I know you can't read that, but we've got over the next 20-year period is about $20 million worth of improvement identified. About $11 million of that is upgrading the wastewater treatment plant from 2 to 4 million gallons per day.
Were those in order of priority?
Pardon me?
Were those in order of priority?
Those are in the categories, yeah.
I mean, within, I just, no, go back one screen.
No, they're not in order because all of these are priority investments.
All right.
So we avoid, the Planning Commission avoided doing 1, 2, 3, 4.
From within the priority one, you didn't prioritize them outside of the, I mean, inside of the category.
Yeah. This is in priority two.
That's what I meant, within each priority.
Actually could have gone into priority three because it's actually identified about a 300% increase in residential demand for sewer over the next 20
But those sewer projects that were just listed, there were 10 of them, how many, those weren't in order of priority.
Oh no! You have to, you know, look at the plan. They're all recommendations to respond to projected growth in the West Valley.
Okay.
And I mean, the master plan probably has some things that probably need to be done first or whatever. But
okay, that's my question.
Yeah.
I just want some clarification. I almost feel like I'm in a budget workshop session here with department heads. I think, and Mr. Carpenter, I'd like you to step up to the mic and give me some clarification. And be very straightforward. I think that we're just about crossing a little bit of a red line with this comprehensive plan. I feel like it's not really their job to come before us to tell us what each department needs. such as, and don't get me wrong, I appreciate the work y'all have done, Mr. Shaw, Mr. Gibson, but when you talk about the detention facility being rated for 89, you know, having 206 normal capacity, you know, the minimum standards of South Carolina will dictate to us, and they will certainly be on us, and we know where we stand on that. You talk about the fire stations, talk about the sewer. I understand all this, but are we not crossing a little bit of a red line with the Planning and Zoning Commission when they come for us with these department head requests? And that's pretty much about what it boils down to. Am I right or wrong?
Right. Well, no, I don't know that you're wrong. Absolutely not wrong. But I think what the Planning Commission is doing is the law requires they identify needs. And they're identifying needs without trying to put it in a position or presentation of they're saying you have to do it. They're just identifying some needs as they see it, sharing it with council. Law is up. It's always the council's decision on what those needs actually are.
So basically, in the 5-year comprehensive plan, they should be meeting with department heads. They should be going over their budgets with them. They should be going over their capital, with their 5-year projections. They should be putting all this. You're telling me this is the way it's normally done in a 5-year comprehensive plan? I want Mr. Carpenter to answer this question.
I certainly don't question their effort in finding as much data and information as they can and in getting it from the horse of mouth, so to speak, and going to department heads to determine what. Nothing in here is new. These are all issues and needs that department heads already have. They've already determined these are needs. Some of them they've had for years. So I don't know that the Planning Commission has created anything. They have just collected data that's already out there from the department heads.
Are we going in circles? I mean, these guys, the Planning Commission has worked very hard. I just don't know that I agree that it's necessarily their responsibility to come before us with each department head's request and needs for capital investment within the next 5 years. I don't know. Go ahead, Lewis. I'm sorry.
You may be thinking about the capital improvement plan, which was very specific. We did meet the department heads. We did look at dollar figures, and we made recommendations on projects that exceeded $100,000. But we're not doing that anymore. In consultation with the administrator, the Planning Commission is not doing that. This is a separate document. It's a broader picture document. It does have figures in it, but those figures that you just saw came from an engineering study that was done for long-range planning for the sewer system. So we're not here specifically recommending any department's particular budget. At the Planning Commission, we're just saying if the county wants to grow, we need to pay attention to the sewer system, and we need to have some idea of where we want to be with that sewer system.
And I wasn't specifically pinpointing the sewer system. It was all the above, the fire stations, the detention center, the sewer system. It's almost like we're going through a departmental budget workshop session here.
And Mr. Jones, I
think that's why you made some changes when you came on board. Am I right or wrong?
Yes, sir. Correct.
Thank you.
Yes, sir. And as Mr. Shaw did indicate, at my request, I have removed from the Planning Commission the role of making capital improvements requests to the council and to the county. So they don't make those. They used to make them, and now I have removed that from them, so that can be an administrative and a council function to do. I think what they're doing is just, again, cut and pasting and providing as part of what the law requires they provide to the community.
So you're telling me, and I just want clarification, and guys, I'm not knocking anybody. I want clarification. So we're sitting here and we're listening to all this information about each departmental's budget and their capital request, and that's part of their job.
As I understand, yes, sir, to provide what they see the capital.
As you understand from who?
Just my general understanding as an administrator.
Okay.
Well, I was also just going to help clarify too, in our agenda packet with the ordinance that we're being asked to adopt on Tuesday, It's actually required by the Planning Enabling Act of 1994. And so they're just doing their job. And it's just, and I would just say, Mr. James, they're giving us a roadmap, okay? And it's through their efforts, through certainly with the input of department heads. I mean, otherwise they would have no way to get this information. So certainly it involves, or has involved at some point, the input of department heads. It's really the first, I think you can, the first page under tab B, but it's the Planning Enabling Act, and it requires a 5-year review of the comprehensive plan. So it's just state law that they're required to have a 5-year review of the comprehensive plan. And it's my understanding that that's what that is. Is that right, Mr. Newman?
That's correct.
And so they're not telling us what we have to do. They're not, you know, I don't even know they're suggesting anything. They're just saying that these are the needs that have been identified. Here it is. Do with it what you will. Obviously, over the last 5 years, I don't think we've done a whole lot that's on there. So, you know, I don't think there's any, you know, great sense of urgency there. So it's a requirement of state law that we have the Planning and Zoning Commission conduct this comprehensive review. That's what I understand.
And I understand the promise of state law to have a comprehensive review, a comprehensive plan, all of the above. I was just asking for clarification about the contents of it. You know, it just sounds like a department head budget meeting to me.
Well, and again, all they're really doing is providing information that's already there. This is just taken from the solid waste plan, taken from the sewer plan, taken from the road bridge study, information that we know is already there by and large. So,
John, I got one question. You put up the census number that's through 2010, and then all this stuff, all these recommendations are for expanding facilities. What's the population going to be in the next 10 years? Because that would, you know, we already have housing for 61,000 people. You put a lot of things up there about housing and this and that, but you don't build something unless you anticipate a certain amount of workload based on an influx of residents. So are you recommending this trend of 38% is going to continue the next 10 years, or what's the basis?
There's population projections that are in the, I don't know what they are for the next 10 years. They're projections that were done by Santee Lynch's Regional Council of Governments, and some of them that were done by the state looking at their projections.
But it's all this workload based on those population projections?
They're based on continued growth, correct? At least priority number 3, which we haven't gotten to, is, you know, to meet future demand.
Okay, thank you.
Can I ask you just a couple questions?
Sure.
Okay.
So work session.
Thank you. When we talk about market incentives for affordable housing, exactly what are you, I know you're not recommending, you're not suggesting or recommending, you're just sort of saying that's something we need to look at?
Well, we were recommending that zoning district. As a response to the state requirement, should we develop market incentives for affordable housing? That being, you know, something that, keeping in mind for the developer to be able to make money would be, you know, higher density. Now, I might add, this would only work if it's an area where public sewer is provided, because you're not going to be able to.
We do have some of that now, though, don't we?
That's correct. You mean?
Market incentives for the housing. We do have that now, don't
no,
we?
No,
for the affordable housing.
No, sir. We don't have any.
We just have designated areas.
No, sir.
It seems like it. I mean, when I see construction, I'm seeing when I ride around, I see where.
There certainly is a lot of low-end market housing, but that.
They seem to all be in one area.
Right.
So I just didn't know.
No, that's not of any concerted effort on the county, is what that's strictly with developers.
Let me ask you another question, talking about, and just going back before I forget, talking about the buffer area. You know, when we talk about the national park status, you know, how would that affect current landowners that would be in that buffer area now?
Well, if it became national or park or state park, you know, they would purchase property. You know, so it would be part of, it would be protected under, you know, their ownership. But the second line of defense, if that didn't happen, would be to approach landowners with voluntary conservation easements. And then the third, which I think is probably, I mean, the fourth, which I put down at the bottom, would be probably least desirable, but it would be a form of protection of creating an overlay district which would restrict certain uses, like I said, like, you know, cell towers, power transmission lines, or, but not traditional uses like residences, farms, churches, schools, and things of that nature.
Okay, thank you, John. Can I just say one thing? Carol's raised her hand, and I didn't mean to cut her off, but if the council doesn't mind, I'd like to hear what she was.
Well, when you were questioning the things about the list of things on the priority investment, the top, the capital things that they were talking about, the reason why they're in there is state law required that we add a priority investment element. So that is added, and state law required that the Planning Commission identify capital needs. So what they were doing was not something that they thought that they were going to meddle into budgetary things or what the county needs or what y'all's business was. They were doing what was required of them by state law. And that list that they're doing, like was explained later, is nothing that they're telling y'all you have to do. They were just required to come up with those specific needs. But it's state law, and that's why they did it.
All right, so Carol, what you're saying is that that's pretty common in every county, every
yeah,
county does it this way.
Everybody has to do it, every city, every municipality.
So you're not coming, as in the past, when we had recommendations from the Planning Commission, this needed to be done, that needed to be done. That's not the case here, it's just identifying the needs. Because I think we all know that there's every jail in the state of South Carolina is overpopulated. If you find me one that has met the minimum standard requirement, I'd like to shake your hand, because they're obviously got some very high taxes and spending a lot of money. And that's just one, but Carol, you put it in plain English, and I appreciate that. That answers my question. Thank you.
Mr.
Miller? Go ahead. Okay. As I was going to say, that the utilities director just came down today, and he said we're approaching capacity already for 2 million gallons per day, so the upgrade is going to be necessary. The plan is designed to go up to 6 million gallons per day, but that's way better in the future.
What's the cost of that?
That's about $11 million to go through.
Where would that come from?
Currently, it was funded through the State Infrastructure Fund and paid for by the countywide.
Borrowed.
Pardon me?
It was borrowed.
Correct.
Yeah. It wasn't funded, it was borrowed. The taxpayers haven't paid for it. Yeah. I mean, I just wanted to.
He was getting to that, and you cut him off. He's saying it was through the sewer district tax.
Mm-hmm. Why didn't he
pay for it? It was borrowed from the State Infrastructure Fund, which is a very good rate, you know, of interest. But it is interest rate. It was borrowed and was being paid for by the countywide sewer fund. Mm-hmm.
The sewer tax.
Correct, tax. Okay, the next recommendation on priority two, again, it's come up several times about, you know, the courthouse, and once again recommending a facilities condition and assessment and space study. It appears to me there's quite a bit of area in the court that may be underutilized, might be, you know, more efficiently used. The past recommendations were to do something about the elevator because of American Disability Act, but you guys have already acted on that, and our maintenance director is getting bids now to do the elevator. County Industrial Park recommendations, the Planning Commission doesn't have any specific recommendations now because we understood that the Economic Development Strategic Plan was being developed. I just now today got a copy of it, but I haven't even had a chance to look at it. The Planning Commission certainly hasn't seen it, so they deferred, you know, you guys have, you know, look at that and act on it as you see fit, but they certainly support the our industrial parks. Library recommendations, everybody's aware of, you know, the history of that with the local option tax pool report. Elgin, that quite a bit of needs have been recognized for the Camden Library. I'm happy to report, I was just over there. They're doing a tremendous amount of work for small funds over at the Camden Library to try to help that out. A lot of it's being done by our guys in-house, and I think the end result is going to be a lot more efficient. I need a space, but the planning commission recommends pursuing any funding that the county sees fit to help with the library system. And, of course, recreation facility, we all know the history of that. Once again, the planning commission supports recreation, makes no specific recommendations as to dedicating funds for any particular project, just showing general support for it. Solid waste recycling centers, those dots are 5 mile radius centers. The red ones are proposed new location. The blue ones are proposed moving existing locations to another one, and the green ones are existing locations. There's 5 proposed new centers. Recommendation is to implement the program as much as possible over the next 10-year period. I believe the solid waste was talking about a 5-year rise in the planning commission, so let's look at the 10-year. And also, there's been studies done by solid waste that they feel that they can do the hauling much more cheaper and efficiently themselves from there to the recycling facilities over the landfill than they're currently doing under contract. So it's recommended to go there.
Is that something new?
That's budget issues, isn't it?
That's an administrative decision, I think.
I do too. Right?
You have the cost, I do a cost benefit analysis.
Yeah, and again, that's just the first that I've heard of that, and that's why, look, it's just a roadmap. It brings it to our attention to say.
You didn't know that?
To say, I said, I didn't know that.
But it's an
administrative decision. The auditor certainly knew it because.
It's an administrative decision.
He and
Jim just said.
He and Dana Reeder have been talking about it.
It's something that we'll have to factor into the budget process next year. That's the only reason that I even mentioned it, is that I was interested in it, and I hope to hear more about it.
I'm just having some nice conversation.
I just want to ask a question, because it's an administrative decision, does it delete us out from knowing? I mean, I think we need to know what he's making decisions on.
So the department doesn't let us know?
I didn't say that. I'm just saying, responding to what she says, it's an administrative decision. I think no one's arguing that point.
The chair would agree with it.
But it's good to keep us informed. That's the first I've heard of it as well.
Well, we might have heard of this during our budget process.
We may have.
Just asking questions.
And again, what the Planning Commission has done is just collected information that's out there and put it together for council's, you know, consideration, certainly, but they're just pointing out issues that we're going to have to face in the next 10 years. And they're also pointing out some of the possible solutions that we may look at in the next 10 years. I would be remiss if I implied that we are not considering options for the next 10 years. We are. In every department, we're looking at possible options for the next 10 years of where we're going to go. That's really what they're doing, is they're showing that is actually in effect, that we actually are planning and we are anticipating what the needs are can. Now, am I ready to present? No, I'm not ready to present these in detail to the council at this point, but the Planning Commission is showing you that there are options that are out there that we're considering as staff, and in some cases they'll come up with a budget this year. In other cases, we really won't go into them for a couple of years because we either can't pay for it or because it's not on the horizon that we anticipate. So all they're doing is again, as the law says, that they have to show what the needs are and some possible directions that we can go in, and certainly we've got some directions to go in, but, you know, in some cases, I'm not ready to go into great detail. I certainly can explain what we have discussed in some of them, but, you know, it's not like we're going to come to the council the next meeting or 2 meetings and give you a comprehensive $50 million plan. Because that's not the point we're at. In a lot of cases, these are just in-house estimates anyway, what we think it would cost. We haven't got to the point of, because it's premature for us to even do that. because we know that we're not in a position where we can either build some of these facilities. But again, you know, staff is certainly anticipating the needs. That's really all this is showing, is the staff is anticipating needs that are out there and has some idea of what some of the solutions may look like.
Well, these are not the type of things that you call a local hardware store to get done in 2 weeks. So if you don't start planning for them now, in a 3, 5, 10-year plan, we're going to be behind the eight ball. So if we don't start planning them, and I think the Planning Commission has done a wonderful job. I think it's a great presentation. I think it puts us right where we need to be to look down the road. Because if we're reaching our maximum of 2 million gallons of the wastewater or whatever right now, we need to start looking in that right away. If we're reaching our capacity, then obviously that's somewhere that we need to start looking. Because, like I say, we're not going to call down the street and get that done in 2 weeks. So I think it's a good plan. It puts us where we need. And in effect, some of these will prioritize themselves. So I think it's a good presentation.
And the comprehensive plan is really not meant to have the pencil sharpening detail of it's got a lot of figures in it, but you know, when you guys decide to move, a lot more homework needs to be done to implement. It's just a guide.
Mr. Chairman, I'd like to say something. You know, Mr. Gardner is absolutely right. If we reach capacity, something's got to change with our sewer. So we either raise taxes, borrow more money, or we bring jobs into this community. I'm not going to vote to raise taxes to expand anything. We need to get industry in here. We need to get jobs in here if we want to expand.
Okay, and the last part is each element, and once again now I'm talking about the big comprehensive plan, 2006-2016. Each element in the comprehensive plan, you know, has certain policies and goals and objectives. The last element of the plan was taking some major key recommendations that were made and that embodies the spirit of the entire of the entire plan. And this is pretty much just a report on where we stand and what we've done so far. The CIP, that's already been discussed. The Planning Commission produced 3 of them, and they're not doing it anymore. Concurrency or adequate public facilities, that's a policy where if a development is proposed, we need to have the adequate infrastructure to handle the development. It's not an anti-development tool because, again, it's our responsibility to provide the infrastructure to anticipate growth. There are many jurisdictions that have an ordinance in place that has points that are given for each for road, water, sewer, or whatever, and if a development doesn't accrue so many points or has less, then it's denied. The Planning Commission thought that was a little bit too much for Kershaw County to be looking at something like that. So we responded, and this is in our regulations now. The larger developments require the planning staff to report this development to a whole list of agencies, utility providers, even the Postal Service, to give them an opportunity to comment on the development, you know, to state any concerns that they have. And we've been doing that, you know, since 2010. So that's been taken care of. It recommended a comprehensive update to the zoning and land development ordinances. You guys remember the process in 2010 where we updated the zoning ordinance, the land development ordinance, and the county engineering standards into one document, Commission accomplished. The review or revision of the future land use map, we've looked at that several times. The new master sewer plan and the economic development plans are still in accord with the future land use map, and at this point there has not been any need to revise the map, but we're certainly looking at it every time. And to establish comprehensive planning as a continuous process, you know, we had this mandated 5-year review right the year after the 10-year plan came out, we hit a recession, there really hasn't been much going on, but certainly the objective is we don't wait for the next 5 years. If something needs attention, then we would go through the process of adding it to the comprehensive plan. And that
is it. Well, thank you, and I want to thank you for all your work on this, Mr. Younger, but in particular, I want to recognize Lewis and George. The county is blessed to have people of your caliber to be associated and volunteer. And please extend that to all members of the Planning and Zoning Commission. We're very thankful for what you do. Thank you.
Yes, we are.
Next, Mr. Carpenter.
Sorry, I got spots in my eyes, so I'm trying to read now. Okay, resolution to approve the substance abuse and testing policy, Mr. Chairman. What this is basically is just a modification to ensure that our county personnel policies are current and compliant with the law. As the law says, we must have four substance abuse, drug testing, random drug testing, et cetera.
Okay, thank you.
This is a change? We don't have one.
Well, no, sir, we have a policy, but this is just updating the current employee policy that we have to just make sure that, again, we're...
What are some of the little things?
Yeah, I don't see like lines struck through or things added or anything. I mean, this is a total overhaul, I guess, is what you're saying.
Yes, sir.
All right.
Yes, sir.
Okay. And pursuant to, I guess, consultation with employment lawyers, probably?
Yes, sir. That's really what is the result of this, to ensure that, again, in administering random drug tests, among other things, that we are compliant with the law, as it dictates how we must carry them out on existing employees.
Thank you.
As the law requires, yes, sir. Every employee, no, but because we're not allowed to do every employee. But certainly those employees who are CDL drivers.
When I was job administrator, they tested me 5 times in 2 years.
Certain classes of employees, you can. This is making sure that our policy reflects what the law says.
You should take it personally, Mr. Jones. I don't think they were trying to send a message.
Yes, sir. Next item is essentially a resolution for council that would authorize the execution of an amendment to the existing agreement between Kershaw County and various entities for providing the sewer in the county. Essentially, what this is Mr. Ken Queen is here tonight. As you recall, some months ago when we discussed and council gave green light to start a process that would allow the extension of sewer from the Palmetto Utilities facility to the Kelsey Ridge subdivision. And what this agreement resolution tonight is for council to discuss, basically one of the conditions that Mr. Queen was given was that he needed to go and get buy-in from the other entities that were signatories along with Kershaw County. This is essentially a resolution that would publicly communicate the council's support of this. So the other entities they're not going to go forward with it unless they really know Kershaw County is too. They're not going to go through the effort of signing off something only if Kershaw County say they're not going to do it. So this is just publicly affirming Kershaw County's desire to see the Kelsey Ridge be serviced by sewer from Palmetto Utilities. Ms. Keene?
It's consistent with his presentation.
Yes,
certainly that one subdivision where we can't provide sewer, but
that's correct.
But Palmetto Utilities, it made sense to
get
him to do it. Okay, any questions? Mr. Small.
Just wanted to go over so briefly. All right, just want to make sure that the property requested is the property described in Exhibit 2. Is that right, Mr. Bose?
Yes, it's 5-0 to the property in Exhibit 2.
That's roughly 152 acres. So
I think it's 256 houses. Is that it? Something like that.
Total.
And that eight, but that's the acreage described there. It's like 26 in one track and 126 in another.
Yes.
All right. And it has no, it has no other impact outside of what's right there.
It says that delineates that. And also, if you the resolution says that Kershaw County will have to amend its sewer franchise ordinance, which will take three readings, but Mr. Queen will have to go circulate this document. So it'd be my suggestion, if the council approves this next Tuesday, that they go ahead and read the amendment to the franchise ordinance twice, so that when Mr. Queen brings this back fully executed, then they can just read it the third time, the amendment to the franchise ordinance, then you'd be ready to go.
Thank you.
Mr. Derry?
We had another question in reference to or asked, will the lot sizes change? Because I know currently that some people out there have septic tanks, and if they get sewer, lot sizes could possibly change.
No, our lot sizes will remain. What's happened is the county development ordinance has changed. That says that we would have to increase the size of our lots if we did not have sewer, which is readily available, 1,600 foot length. So if we were, I could not maintain the half acre size lots that I have if we don't get the sewer.
Well, you could.
I have to.
You could maintain half acre.
Not on a septic tank, it's.
Yes, public water without a septic tank is half an acre. Public water with well and septic tank is three quarters of an acre. Half an acre of public water and septic.
Public water with well and septic?
If it's a well and septic tank, it's three quarters of an acre. If it's public water with a septic tank, it's a half an acre. So you could do a half an acre.
To answer your question, in short, no, our lot sizes will not change. We had a master plan. Originally, we have not modified that at all. We anticipate staying on the same program. That's why people come to that development.
And we do not have sewer. The county does not have sewer available.
Yes, sir.
You know, I think this is a win-win for everybody. I really do. And I hope this council will move forward with this. I feel that. Feel they will. And it certainly dulls my blade a little bit with our current sewer system, knowing that we will work and bend and work in those gray areas when it's possible. Thank you.
Mr. Gary, you done?
Yeah, well, I just don't want values of homes to decline. The other people that's already in there, because you know some people don't come in. Because I've heard from homeowners out there presently that you know they have three quarter acres. And that if we provide sewer there, they could scale back to half an acre and then.
Actually, Mr. Gary, the largest lot I have in the development right now is 0.52 acres in phase one, the 82 lots that were phase one. And so we, in actuality, the value of the properties are going up. Our plans and our models, the plans that we will build in the next phase, increase property prices, sales prices will increase $30,000 to $50,000. So as anywhere you hear rumors and innuendo, we're actually going to a bigger, larger new product in phase two. In phase three, we hope to grow that and get more.
Doesn't zoning prevent that anyway, though? I mean, Mr. Newman, what is zoning?
Well, in answer to all of these things, this is zoning R15. If public sewer is available, the minimum lot size is 15,000 square feet, which is 0.32 acres. All of Mr. Queen's proposed lots well exceed the minimum size. And so, I mean, you know, he was actually proposing about the same size as phase one.
Thank you, Mr. Queen. Appreciate it.
Any other questions? This is something that staff is fully in support of as well, and as Mr. Jones indicated, it just makes sense. The county can't run sewer there. It doesn't make sense for us to try to run sewer to the property. And certainly, anytime we can see growth starting back up in the county, that's a good thing to see. So we're encouraged by what this can do for us. So.
City on board? Sorry, city's good?
Mr. Queen, we haven't gone and asked anybody. That's
we were doing the first.
Again. They don't want to move forward until they know we're on board.
We're just taking the first step. Yeah. And if the others follow,
we can still be shot fall. Down, but not by us.
Right.
Yeah. Central Midlands are one of the cities where they hardly agreed to it.
Holiday schedule.
Yes, sir, Mr. Chairman. I just need to let council know that you are currently scheduled to have a meeting on December 25th. You are certainly welcome to continue that schedule. That is the second meeting in December. If you do so, I feel sorry for Mr. Trapp because he will have to be here with you and I will plan on taking vacation day that day. But I would like to recommend to council that they go ahead and cancel the December 25th scheduled meeting of the council.
You want us to reschedule it?
Move it up a day, like 24th, maybe?
That'd be voted out.
I assume we're also not going to have a work session on Thanksgiving Day.
That is correct.
Also the plan.
Yes. And then as you, if you look, you'll see that there for the current holiday schedule, the county is passed for the employees would have Christmas Day and the day after Christmas as well as Thanksgiving and the day after Thanksgiving. So those are the holidays in this calendar year.
That's just the way it falls. It's always been that way. Before you start adding more days.
Well,
I do have a question. I'm sorry.
No, go right ahead. I'll follow.
In reference to, we've also, Councilman Jones, as you have stated, we've always followed the state holidays as well, which is going to be the Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday.
No, we have not. Only
yes,
once or twice we've done that.
Look back.
Our policy always stated.
I'm not talking about the policy. I said what council has done.
I just want to be open for the public as much as possible.
I'm telling you what council actions has been. You can look back over the last 6-7 years. We have followed the same holidays as the state has taken. Because even if they can access here, they still can't go out to DMV and do it.
Well,
and he remembers Mr. Tucker because he voted for it too. But anyway. Yeah, that was.
I did, Mr. Smoke, but I'm saying, I'm just telling you that I don't want us closing extra days during the holidays when people have business to conduct, and we should be open for the folks that we serve.
Right, and
that's all I'm saying.
And
I did reluctantly vote for it last time.
We're gonna give you the opportunity again.
I'm sure you will.
That was my point. Is I plan. I asked county administrator to put that in. Currently Christmas Eve, 23rd, which is Monday.
I'm not surprised.
We're planning to be open, and quite a few of our departments, probably more than half, depend on the state for their resources, their ability to basically do their job. And the state, outside of our control, Mr. Jones, I wish I had some control there, but the state has decided that it should be, its offices should be closed on the 24th, 25th, and 26th. And I would recommend and hope that you'll support us doing the same. I don't think we'll be very effective and get much done on Christmas Eve here at the county office.
I have a question.
I'll be happy to answer, Mr.
Chairman. No, this is for the chairman.
Go ahead.
Mr. Chairman, you're the CEO of Target. Are y'all closed Christmas Day?
We are.
Are you closed the day before or the day after?
We close at 6 p.m. on the 24th. We open again at 6 a.m. the day after.
Okay. So I don't want to hear any complaints from any county employees about not having enough holidays. You go to work for industry, Invista, Target, the rest.
Will the chairman be there on Thursday?
I'm just saying.
And for the record, no county employee has complained to me. No. It wasn't my decision to establish the state holiday.
Citizens complained to me, just wanting to come and conduct business.
On Christmas Eve?
Closed. No, Councilman Smoke. Okay. You know that.
Well, that's what we're proposing is to get. Our policy already says Christmas Day and the day after. And so what I'm going to propose is that the county offices be closed on Christmas Eve. Yes. All right. Ask that be on the agenda for.
I would recommend and suggest we stay with.
What is on the agenda?
It's on the agenda.
All right.
Now, I would point out for members of council that obviously some departments in the county, regardless of council decision, will be open on those days. Clearly, 911 will be open. The sheriff's office will be running. Solid waste and recycling are open the day after Christmas and closed.
Councilman Jones will be answering his cell phone that day.
I absolutely will. No question about it.
Any other questions?
No.
Okay. Then item F would be just a discussion of a proclamation for National Hunger and Homelessness Awareness Week.
Okay.
And then.
Is that a resolution or a proclamation?
That's proclamation.
Okay. All right.
And then that leads into the last item, which is again, the use of resolution for proclamations. Last time we did discuss it in some detail, and it got tabled and carried over. Therefore, it is still all business out there for a possible discussion if council chooses to.
I say we leave it as it is. Don't fix something that's not broke. Because if we start putting more bureaucracy in it, it'll be all messed up.
I would say that in light of the question Mr. Tucker asked at the last meeting about the use, should council choose to pass this modification to its rules, council needs to remember that you can always still do a resolution if you wish. You can always choose to do that. So should you elect to have proclamations, that will never stop council from doing a resolution as well. If you wish to pass a resolution in support or in recognition of anything, council will always have that ability.
But we can't take this up at Tuesday's meeting because it's in the work session.
Well, we're putting it on the table, so.
It's not a whole business, it's not a work session.
I understand, I'm just questioning my request of work session only put on it, but nothing else. No, it's a fact, it's not a try.
This kind of expands things, the way I'm reading it. Proclamations are to be issued by county council or by a county council member. So an individual member at any given time put together a proclamation and deliver it to a group that they so choose.
Absolutely. It's intended to allow council members the utmost flexibility of recognizing individuals and groups and communities.
We can do that anyway. We can do that anyway.
I had a shaky feeling.
Mr. Gary and I did it at one point in time about a couple of years ago, just two signatures. I mean,
I hadn't seen it.
We didn't ask your permission to smoke.
Okay. Anything else anybody wants to talk about?
I do. Go ahead. Just very quickly. What I told you, I wanted to challenge my agenda item, Fine Arts Center work session on it. Go ahead, Mr. Smoke, on your chair. I think it's debatable whether it can be on the agenda Tuesday night. Do you not disagree?
I actually agree. I think it's on the agenda as new business, just because it says in parentheses work session. I mean, it is on the agenda for Tuesday night's meeting. And that maybe the parentheses in the work session means it's to be discussed or there's a presentation, but I think it's on the agenda.
I want to hear our opinion on that.
I don't know how, you know, if there are a number of your colleagues who are urging you to wait until the following meeting, I don't know how wise it is to bring it up.
You know what? This is your decision. It's up or down. You're either for it or you're against it.
I think council could act on it if they chose to. I agree with Smoke. If council chooses.
Why didn't you agree with me earlier when I asked the question?
With this work session.
But you told me it had to be in the work session earlier. Remember we talked about this?
I said it was a work session. I didn't say the council could not choose to do it. Council, I think, can choose to do it.
So basically, what you're saying to me is that it is on the agenda for Tuesday night.
Yes.
Well, that's not what I was told earlier, or maybe I misunderstood, I'm sure, but I'm glad to know now that there's been clarification and that it's on the agenda for Tuesday night.
I was not getting into policy discussion council was having about whether or not they wish to consider it.
Okay, it's on the agenda. Anything else?
I'm done.